Super Invasion in 2008. So her main research interest includes modeling of solar coronal loops, solar granulation, extragalactic plasmas, and structure formation through hydrodynamics. She has a large number of research papers to her credit in these areas, and she had guided 4 research students for their PhD thesis. She was the editor of many conference proceedings and also served as the chief editor of the Bulletin of the Astronomical Society of India for several years. She has also published 3 books, Astrophysical Plasmas and Fluids, 1998, published by the Clure Academic Press, and Plasmas, the First State of Matter, 2014, which was published by the Cambridge University Press, and Physics of Partially Ionized Plasmas, 2016, also published by the Cambridge University Press. Professor Binoti, she is a recipient of Dr. Vikram Sarabhai Research Award for Space Sciences, 1992, and she is also a fellow of the National Academy of Sciences India since 1996. So it is with great pleasure, on behalf of IA 50 Organizing Committee, I welcome Professor Binod Kishan to deliver her lecture, Plasmas, the First State of Matter. So Professor Binod Kishan.
Thank you. Thank you, Aruna. You have done your homework very well. And actually, it is in 1977 that I joined IAEA, and before that I was in the Indian Institute of Science. So you can imagine that you are celebrating 50 years, and out of those 50 years, I have been associated with IAEA for more than 43 years. So it's a long time. And so you can imagine that when I joined, the institute was just coming up. So automatically I became a part of everything that was happening there, starting from canteen to guest houses to offices to library, anything that an institute requires. So I became a part of that. And in fact, those days, Koramangala was so quiet, I didn't know how to go back. The first time I came with my husband, I went to IAEA with my husband, and he said there were such beautiful fields all around IAEA that he's going for a walk. So he didn't stay in the institute and went out for a walk, and I had my chat with Professor Bapu, Vinu Bapu. And the second time when I actually joined, just after a few weeks, I think. And so I didn't know how to go back to this part of the northern part of the city. So Professor Bapu, as he was always very considerate, very kind, so he asked me how I am going back. I said I had no idea. I will find out. And then he requested Professor C.H.V. Shastri, who used to stay in this part of the city those days. And actually many of the people were staying here because IAEA campus was still getting ready. And so most of the people were actually sitting in Rama Research Institute and living in this area where I am living now. So he requested him to, you know, take me back home. So I was really very well taken care of from the day I joined. So I have some very pleasant, lovely memories of those days and all the encouragement I got from Professor Bapu and all the other colleagues. In fact, the very first day after I joined, Professor Bapu asked me to think of working with the radio astronomy group. And so that was very nice because they were observing, this Gauribidhur observatory was new. And they had just started getting data on solar radio bursts, type 3 bursts. And it involved a lot of plasma physics as an explanation, theoretical explanation of the phenomenon. So I kind of just fitted immediately very well, which was good for me and also good for the group. And we started publishing papers from that Gauribidhur data. So one of my very first papers is from Gauribidhur data. and of which I'm very proud. And also, you know, it kind of guided me always to keep observations in my mind or in front of me and to build theories around it. So that always remained throughout. I think it is because I started with the radio astronomy group that it happened. So that was a good training I got in the beginning. And of course, slowly I diversified into different areas, as Aruna mentioned. I really enjoyed my stay very much in IAEA and still enjoying. And I hope this, my association, of course, will stay forever. And I hope from the other side also, IAEA will also like to be associated with me as long as it is possible. So thank you very much for this opportunity, and I'm happy to participate in these celebrations as an old timer. And I really wish all of you very well in the future to come. So let me start my talk now. Plasma is the first state of matter. You know, astronomers always knew that plasma, the universe began in a soup of plasma. But it is the plasma physicists who took some time to realize that plasma is the first state of matter. And they were pretty happy with calling plasma as the fourth state of matter. So, you know, I also took nearly three decades to, you know, come out in the open about this state of matter. And why not? When we can be the first state of matter, why should we be happy with the fourth state of matter? And this is not only in the name. I believe that the processes of element formation in the universe, the way we delineate them and study them, will probably, if we keep them in mind, will probably change our understanding of element formation in the laboratory. So it's not that we always go from iron downwards. We could also go this way, which is probably hard, but which we are trying in the form of plasma reactors, tokamaks, where hydrogen, thermonuclear fusion of hydrogen is the main aspiration and dream of most of the world, plasma physicists of the world. So so let me begin my plan. So I will just, some of the these things are well known to some of you, but I am mostly talking to the youngsters. So it's the plasma universe. Plasmas are everywhere. And then I will also mention some plasmas in laboratory, plasma materials and methods. And there are different types of plasmas. And how does one define a plasma? And techniques. How does one study a plasma? There are different techniques. Depending upon the question you ask, there are different techniques. And so on. Let me see how far I go. So as I mentioned, the plasma, usually people, even my plasma physicist friends still start their talk with saying plasma, the fourth state of matter. And if I am sitting there, then they just look at me and say, oh, no. So plasma is considered, was considered, as far as I am concerned, the fourth state of matter, starting with solid, liquid, gas, and plasma, as you know all. But that is not how nature does it. Nature does it entirely in the reverse manner. Universe originated in a hot soup. So it was first plasma, then gas, then liquid, then solid. In fact, some of these formations of solids and liquids and solids, particularly solids, still we have to understand these element for solid formation in the universe. So universe began in an extremely hot plasma soup of elementary particles. As it expands and cools, recombination sets in and neutralization of the plasma takes place. So it's not that the entire universe is has always been in a fully ionized state. And there are epochs, there are time periods in the history of the universe where part of the plasma became neutral because of the recombination. And these eras are very, very important. And right now, as you know, some of you know, that many facilities are being built to understand this recombination and second reionization, etc., of the universe. So because the plasma became neutral, partly neutral at some stage during its expansion and cooling, so the earliest partially ionized plasma forms, and complete neutralization, which lasts until the first quasars and galaxies are born, due to the UV radiation of which will then again start ionizing the matter. And that is the reionization epoch of the universe. And the state of partial ionization again obtained. So there are two very important eras of partial ionization of plasmas. And so that is why, towards the end of my talk, I will also stress on the importance of partially ionized plasmas. So this is a picture which everybody has seen. That for example, starting from the Big Bang, the universe with ionized gases, and these are the dark ages where the matter is completely neutral, and then the galaxies and quasars began to form, and the reionization starts. So this early, for example, this phase of this era of the universe, it has mostly partially a very weakly ionized plasmas. A state of partial ionization, why is it different from a normal fully ionized plasma? It's because of the importance of collisions in a partially ionized plasmas, because there are neutral particles there. So for example, the collisional excitation of 21 centimeter radiation in the early universe. And so this is the for example, this marine facilities are built to observe this redshifted 21 centimeter radiation. And here in this, either in the propagation as well as in the absorption of this radiation while it propagates through the up to our telescopes. So this electron hydrogen atom collisions are very important, because that medium, that place where 21 centimeter radiation is produced, which is a neutral hydrogen line. So it would the atoms would suffer electron hydrogen atom collisions, and this should have some signatures on the observation of 21 centimeter radiation. So several low frequency observing facilities are planned, and which would probably help us to understand the processes that are taking place in this era. So radiation propagation through a partially ionized plasma, damping due to electron ion and electron neutral and ion neutral collisions. So these collisions become very important. That's the additional physics that one has to include in the plasma. Usually, if you have a fully ionized plasma, it is mostly collisionless. In fact, I'll show you what is the difference between collisions in a fully ionized plasma and in a partially ionized plasma. So this, as I mentioned earlier, it is especially important for 21 centimeter radiation. These collisions are very important. So more examples, just to show some pretty pictures, because we like to see pictures. Pictures are worth 1,000 words. Equations, beware. I will not show too many equations. And of course, I must say that a picture is worth 1,000 words. The equation is also a picture. You know, that there's various symbols. Instead of colors, it has symbols. That's all. It is also a picture. So this is the Orion molecular cloud. And the important thing to note here is that what are the kind of parameters one is dealing with here? See, for example, the magnetic fields in the microgauss range. So this is important. See, Ni, that is the ion density or the electron density. This is, say, let's say 10 to the minus 4. And neutral density is like more like 10 to the 3 or around that. And so this is again, a partially ionized plasma. Diffuse interstellar gas in two forms, cold clouds of neutral atomic or molecular hydrogen and fully ionized near hot young stars. So collisionally excited lines of silicon, nitrogen, oxygen, etc., which provide information about the temperature and ionization state of the gas. So neutral hydrogen again is detected through the excitation of the 21 centimeter line, and the parameters in these areas are of order. So again, the accretion, this large accretion rate usually associated with hot and fully ionized disks, and low accretion rate produce cold and weakly ionized. And again, here the ratio of the electron density to the neutral densities of the order of this could be a little larger or could be a little smaller than this. Sun, as we know all, a plasma physics laboratory, that's the first object I looked at after joining IAEA. And these are the famous coronal loops over which some work has been done. And these are basically the tracers of the magnetic field in the solar corona. And it is anybody's guess what kind of magnetic field structure is that. Of course, we make simple models, quadrupolar, bipolar, and so on. But it is much more complex than what it appears to be. So the solar photosphere is again one of the coolest regions of the sun. So only a small fraction of the gas is ionized. And this shows the fraction of ionized gas. So this ratio is the neutral hydrogen to proton density as a function of the height. So this is actually quite small. This is since the neutral hydrogen NH is in the numerator, so these numbers are 10 to the 4. Cold and hot solar, you know, sun has such a variety of temperatures that it's not possible to, you know, model any with one kind of set of parameters for every region. The more you resolve it, the more complexities appear, and one has to deal with, you know, different temperature ranges from, let's say, from 20,000 K to 1 million K. So that's the kind of range. And of course, photosphere is 6,000. So you have this whole range from few thousand to few million degrees of temperature. And accordingly, the densities, the magnetic field, the flows are very important. So accordingly, all those other three parameters would also change. And so it's a nice, game and to model, and good physics to model these structures, taking into account the very high quality observations. Those are available now, and they have been available for some time. So partially ionized prominence plasmas, again, this see the temperature, this range is very different. Temperature 6,000 to 10,000 K, densities 1 to 5, 10 to the 10 centimeters per cube, and so on, other parameters. So, you know, the major question in prominence plasma is how cool and dense. So these are dense and cool objects like prominences can be held in thermally isolated from the hot and tenuous corona in which they are embedded. So corona is 1 million degrees, very tenuous. In that, we see these cold and dense prominences. So how are they existing, coexisting with these totally two different temperature and density ranges in these? So their equilibrium and forces, what are the forces acting on them? So see, if it is a fully ionized, if it is a charged component, so magnetic forces can balance the gravity. But what about the neutral component? There is no magnetic field in the neutral component. So with partial ionization, how is the neutral component supported against gravity? So that is one of the questions which has been studied for some time now, and we have also done some work in this regard. So the answer to that, simple answer to that is that, again, because of the collisions, electrons, neutrals are colliding. So it turns out, if one does the detailed theory, it turns out that the neutral matter also starts behaving like a charged fluid because of the collisions. So the ions and electrons collisions with the neutrals, they attribute to the neutrals a kind of property of the ionized component, and therefore they can be influenced by magnetic field. So this is the kind of answer one can give. So plasma tail and dust tail, you know, coexisting here. And so different mechanisms, actually in some pictures, the tail, plasma tail is kind of twisted. In fact, I think IAEA, Professor Sivaraman took these observations of E.K. Sati, and I was happy to, you know, work with him in trying to model this twisted plasma tail structures. Coronal mass ejections, hits the earth and pulsing aurora is any plasma physicist will always show these pictures. But I will show you some very recent. This is the last 24th November or so. So every day I'm getting these pictures, and you know, look at the complexity of the picture. I don't think any simulation or any one kind of model can explain and account for these structures. There's another beautiful picture. It's also very recent, 26th or 27th November. So partially ionized plasmas are collisional. Again, I am emphasizing that collisional processes are electron neutral and ion neutral collisions, elastic collisions, particle scattering, and energy exchange cross section. So energy exchange cross section is basically the size of the particle, geometrical dimensions of atoms and molecules. So the neutral particle or molecule can get polarized because of the collisions. So its charge state will change. So this is a, you know, very, very active dynamical process. And so in elastic collisions, excitation, ionization, charge exchange, all these processes are actually being included. You won't believe that prominence plasma is being modeled, taking five species of particles into account. Five species: hydrogen, neutral hydrogen, protons, and helium, ions of different charge state, other ions for different charge states, and so on. So it's very, very complex process. So collision, see, this is important. I just want to mention, although I promise I will not show you too many equations, electron-ion collisions in a fully ionized plasma are characterized by electron-ion collision frequency, which goes as temperature to the -3/2. So just remember that T -3/2 is the electron-ion collision frequency. On the other hand, electron-neutral collision frequency goes as T to the +0.5. So there's a tremendous difference in the variation of collisional frequencies with temperature. So this is where the, you know, different physics will come into. One has to include, you know, going from fully ionized to partially ionized plasmas. So these things change, and I'm sure there is some crossover at some point. So therefore, the electrical resistivity in a plasma is not only because of the electron-ion collisions, but it should be also included due to electron-neutral collisions. So that becomes very, and in fact, that may be dominant. That may be more. That frequency may be higher than the electron-ion frequency. Plasmas in laboratory. So this is one of the earlier, basically plasmas used for displays. I think it's taking time. It takes, so these are basically electrical discharges, ionization, UV, UV generation, and fluorescence. So these are the steps which are used in any plasma-based displays. So this is one of the earlier examples of phosphorescent glass tube. Thermonuclear fusion, as I mentioned, you know, this is one of the very important international tokamak project involving many countries, in which one, you know, aspires to fuse hydrogen and then hydrogen to helium, so that one, that is a process of energy generation. And this is believed to be pollution-free, as in contrast to nuclear fission. So nuclear fusion is a very favorite, you know, candidate for alternative energy sources, but we are still far from the goal. It is still nowhere near. A lot of complexities, actually, in the early part of these experiments, plasma stability was one of the main problems. And because the magnetic field, along the magnetic field, the plasma particles can just go out, but then they turned around and made a torus, so that plasma remains inside the machine. And some of the MHD instabilities, that plasma tends to expand, plasma tends to go to the walls, and plasma tends to get neutralized. So all those problems have been controlled, but still a lot remains to be done. So laser fusion plasma, this is another scheme by which fusion processes can be achieved by shining lasers on a very small pellet, solid, deuterium tritium pellet. And so many lasers are impinged on that. It gets ionized and ablation is there. And so the center portion gets more compressed and hot. And maybe one expects that the fusion reaction may take place. But all these are still in the experimental stage. Plasma rockets. So this is absolutely on the experimental stage. Not much work has been done. So for rocket motion, because plasmas are very hot and they are very light, so maybe this is fuel for the future. Plasma materials and methods. Plasma surfacing. You know, one of the most important processes for plasma surfacing is plasma nitriding. So instead, of course, there are all these are well-known processes, welding, etching, electroplating, thermal vapor deposition, etc., etc. But one of the really, you know, a live demonstration of the use of plasma nitriding I heard, it was done in, I was in Kathmandu and I was talking about these partially ionized plasmas and then somebody pointed out there that because of plasma nitride, there's a lot of dust in that area. So the water that flows through the pipes carries this dust and the pipes get corroded. So plasma nitriding has helped in making a longer, giving a longer life to these pipes. So this is an absolutely direct application of technical and day-to-day application. So high temperature environment, ion production and exhalation. So all these processes, welding, etching is of course electroplating and deposition. So even if you are depositing one material over another, every process that you are doing in a non-plasma environment, if you do in a plasma environment, it becomes much more efficient. Chemical reactions become much more efficient. So that is why now this plasma processing is being used. Plasma chemistry, new materials, high temperature enhances rates of chemical reactions. Gasification of hospital waste, high current through the waste, and then it can be degraded and more manageable. Plasma-based air and water purifiers are well known because of the UV can treat the matter in the plasmas. This I have already said, displays in plasma television, plasma televisions, I think you know. Plasma, see, this is also a relatively new application, plasmas in medicine. So this, in this picture, there is a this is a finger, there's a hand here, and this is a plasma flame going in which the hand is stuck. The hand is wounded, so it is stuck there. Now you might think that it may burn the hand, but it's a cold plasma torch. It's a cold plasma torch to destroy bacteria in the infection, and it destroys microbial DNA. It's a cold plasma. So this is being, so it, of course the advantages are it can be very, very localized and it heals very fast. There's no heating involved. So this is basically a partially ionized plasma, which is relatively cold, but it can kill those bacteria because of the other components of the plasma. Now, this I just read recently, plasma agriculture from laboratory to farm. Effect of non-thermal plasma and plasma treated water on seed germination and growth enhancement yield. So the seeds are being treated with plasma and the water that is being used for irrigation is also treated with the plasmas and it enhances the yield of the crop. So this is under experimental stage, but I am sure that this will work fine. So this ensuing changes in biochemicals, phytohormones, phytochemicals, antioxidant levels. So all these things in these seeds, which were treated by plasmas and then grown, they had better levels of antioxidants and protein content. They had higher levels of protein content. types of plasmas. So I said fully ionized plasmas, partially ionized plasmas, ultra cold plasma at 1K, very cold, dusty plasma, strongly coupled plasmas, or quantum plasmas. Defining a plasma. So, okay, so we know that plasmas are everywhere in everyday life, in the universe, in lab, in rockets, everywhere. So how, what is it actually for a student, if somebody asks what's a plasma? So one has to say the mixture of positively and negatively charged particles along with some neutral particles. So this term plasma first suggested by Irving Langmuir in 1939 by studying the electric discharge of gases by passing high electric current through cesium atoms. So basically what one has to remember is a plasma has very different properties from its parent neutral gas. So you have hydrogen gas, for example, you have ionized. Now that ionized plasma and the original neutral hydrogen gas, they have very different properties. In fact, this is one of the reasons why it was christened as fourth state of matter, because it actually stands on its own. Its properties are so different from solid, liquid, and gas. It stands on its own, and therefore it deserves to be called a different state of the matter. So what are the kind of forces? As you know, I mean, you have positively and negatively charged particles, so electromagnetic forces will always be there, Lorentz force, and then collisional forces between different species, electron-electron, electron-ion, amongst various species, pressure gradient, because it's a large system, and of course, gravitational forces act. So these are the basic forces which will come into play in a plasma. So now we know that if there is a charge Q, the potential electrostatic potential due to a single charge Q is just given by this distance from the point, and distance at which you are finding the potential. So it's just Q by R. But in a plasma where there is a huge collection of positive and negative charges, this formula does not apply. This is Coulomb formula does not apply. So therefore, this potential is called as screened potential. So what happens, there's a charge Q here, and if it is, let's say, positive charge, so all the other negative charges will accumulate around this Q because it will attract, Coulomb attraction. And so there is a certain distance over which this collection of negative charges will annul the positive charge. So outside this region, as if there is no Q charge is not there. So this is called the screened potential, and this distance is the screening distance. This is a very important property of a plasma. So if one asks you, one gives you some system, say, can you tell, is it a plasma? You must calculate this distance. So what is the, I mean, if this distance is so large, is it larger than the size of the system, then it's not a plasma. It should be within the system, smaller than the size of the system. So these are two or three features which one can immediately calculate, check whether a certain ionized medium qualifies as a plasma or not. This is very important. So by screening length, this, as I again repeated, so it has to be calculated. It depends on the temperature. Higher the temperature, larger it is, higher the density, smaller it is. So this is also called plasma. So how many particles are there in this sphere, in this Debye sphere, is called a Debye sphere. So that number of particles must be very, very large. Now, why is that? Because, see, we have a quantity temperature here. Now, temperature, as you know, is a statistical quantity. You cannot define temperature for one or two particles. You should have enough large number of particles here in order to define temperature. So it's a statistical concept. So the plasma parameter, that is the number of particles in the Debye sphere, must be very, very large. I mean, we say very much larger than one, but it is like 10 to the 10 or 11 or so on. And also very important property of cause is the quasi-neutrality. So overall, you started with a neutral gas. There were no extra charges. You ionized. So the number of positive and negative charges must be equal. But on a small scale, there can be an imbalance between positive and negative charges on a small scale, not on a full system scale. So that's why it's called quasi-neutrality, not strict neutrality, quasi-neutrality at a short scale. So this is also another property of the plasma, and it is because of this that all the electromagnetic phenomena comes into picture, all the waves, production of radiation, other waves, you know, all this because of the charge separation. So quasi-neutrality, and there are two very important frequencies in a plasma. And what is the electron plasma frequency? You often hear, I think my colleagues must have heard it every day from me, and electron plasma frequency and ion plasma frequency. And basically it depends on the density of the particle and the mass of the particle. In a magnetic field, see, it's a plasma, charged particles, magnetic field has to be there because there are currents produce magnetic fields. So what does the magnetic field do? It produces cyclotron motion of the particles, of electrons, ions. And so there are corresponding frequencies, electron cyclotron frequency and ion cyclotron frequency. So, you know, why is it important? These are the kind of, these are the signatures, or one can say these are the characteristics of a plasma which one knows before even doing any problem. So these are the things one must estimate. What is the plasma frequency, ion cyclotron frequency, this. So that you have some idea of why, not the frequency as such, but what are the important time scales and spatial scales in the system. So if, for example, if electron cyclotron frequency is very, very small, or magnetic field is very small, compared to what? Compared to something. So you have to compare these time scales with the time scale of the phenomena which you may be observing. So you are observing some variation over a period of minutes, but the electron cyclotron frequency is, let's say, on milliseconds. The period is on milliseconds. Is it important? So this is what one has to, all these parameters one has to care for, so that we know whether they are relevant for a particular phenomenon or not. In plasmas, not all the species behave alike. This is another very important property. They can have different temperatures. Electrons can have their own temperature. Ions can have their own temperature. And temperatures can be anisotropic. Temperature is a scalar quantity. But even that, we know that it's related to the root mean velocity. So root averages of the thermal velocities, for example, can differ in two different directions. Especially in the presence of magnetic field. Parallel to magnetic field, it can have one temperature. Perpendicular to the magnetic field, it can have another temperature. So particles distributions can be thermal, non-thermal. Non-thermal, power law distributions. All the time we observe that, for example, synchrotron radiation or bursting radiation. It's always from non-thermal distribution of particles. Radio bursts, for example, non-thermal distribution of particles. Particle interactions are more often than not collective. That means it's not that just the two, it's just not the binary collisions. There are a lot of large number of particles in phase move together and affect the system or produce the phenomenon. So a large number of particles get in phase and act cooperatively in phase. So that is why all the processes become much more efficient. For example, in the generation of radiation, bunch of particles, if they act collectively, they can produce much stronger electromagnetic radiation than single just thermal radiation, just sheer by temperature. So non-thermal distributions can exist in a plasma. Techniques, now it comes the real work. So, okay, all this talk is there. So what are the techniques for studying plasmas and plasma phenomena? Plasmas, like any other physical system, are studied by applying the laws of mass conservation, momentum conservation, energy conservation. See, some people are afraid of plasmas. These are the same. It is just like any other system. Basic laws are same. Newton law, mass conservation, basic laws. There's nothing else. Energy conservation, momentum conservation, mass conservation, along with laws of electrodynamics. That's all it takes. It's just a matter of getting familiar with these things. Now, there are, as I had mentioned in my abstract, there are different levels of description of a plasma. So So one can have a kinetic description of the plasma through the time rate of change of the velocity distribution function for each species. Now, velocity distribution function, we are quite familiar, Maxwell-Boltzmann, from kinetic theory of gases, we know Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution. Now, in a plasma, if it is, it can vary with time and space. So if we can study the time and rate of change of this velocity distribution function, we have all the tools, all that we need to know about a plasma, the rate of change of distribution function. It's not under certain conservation laws. Examples where kinetic description is used. So for different, as I said, for different problems, different descriptions have to be used. So where these examples where kinetic description is used. Example one, solar radio bus, because that's the system I first worked on. This is involves a beam plasma instability. That is an electron beam passing through a plasma. So basically electrons, very highly energetic electrons, which are accelerated maybe in the chromosphere or in situ in corona, and then they propagate out into the corona and into the solar wind and so on. So this highly energetic electron beam propagating through a coronal plasma. So this is the basic system which gives rise to the solar radio bursts. And these are observed basically at electron plasma frequency, and they suffer. So what is it? See, for example, this is a ordinary, say, let's say Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution function. Now the electron beam passing through it will have a hump on this. So this is the system which produces solar radio bursts. Now, since this is a radiation, electromagnetic radiation, at in Gaurivitnur, we are measuring at low frequencies, megahertz range. And of course, it is also observed at gigahertz range and so on. So this is where the, wherever you use the distribution function, it's a kinetic description of the plasma. Radiation belts, you know, so as you know that this Van Allen radiation belts, where the particles are trapped in the magnetic field of the Earth. So these trapped particles, they have certain other kind of distribution. They don't have Boltzmann distribution. So they have this, what is called loss cone distribution, where in this cone, for example, this is B, magnetic field, and this is the velocity vector. And so for some angles, the particles are missing. So there is a phenomena here. For example, one can understand from here. So this is a plasma, and plasma particles travel along the magnetic field, and they get reflected from the strong magnetic field regions. So these are strong magnetic. So they are reflected back into the plasma. So this kind of system is represented by this distribution function, where, as I said, that the parallel velocity and the perpendicular velocities can be very different in a magnetic field. So this is another example of that. So these two examples, I think, I gave for kinetic description of the plasmas. Then we have plasmas and radiation, thermal radiation. That just because plasma is hot, you have ionized it, it is hot. So it will produce thermal radiation. And then Thomson scattering of the radiation by the electrons, Compton scattering, high energy electrons. And then, of course, these are the plasma processes on which also I have worked with Professor Gangadhara, stimulated Raman and Brillouin scattering. Okay, so that was kinetic description. Now fluid description. See, that is often used much more often than the kinetic description. Kinetic is used for production of radiation, electromagnetic radiation. Now, fluid description, number of fluids is equal to the number of species of particles in a plasma. So if I have just electrons and protons, I have two fluids, one electron fluid, one proton fluid. If I have partially ionized plasmas, I have three fluids, electron fluid, proton fluid, and neutral particle fluid. So each species of particles can be represented by a fluid. Now, what does that mean? From particles to fluids. So how do we go? From particles, for example, we may have hydrogen molecules, water molecules, but we have water. So water molecules is in the form of individual molecules. Water is in the form of a liquid. So how does one go from water molecules to water? So large number of particles. And so we can define the mass density, fluid mass density, fluid velocity and fluid dynamics by taking the velocity moments of the Boltzmann equation. So taking averages. So if I have a large system, I have Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution, I can find the average velocity, I can find the average of the square of the velocity, I can find average of the cube of the velocity, which is zero for Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution. So one can go from particle picture to fluid picture. Now this is useful for some other kind of phenomena. So in when we take, this is maybe a little technical, but when we take, when we go from one picture to another picture, from particle picture to fluid picture, there is something is lost in translation. So truncation, because we have to, stop this averaging process somewhere. So it, you will find that if you take a second moment of the distribution, it depends on the third moment depends on the fourth moment, and so on. So it is an open system. So truncation and closure, where do you draw a line? Okay, I will go only up to the second moment and not beyond. So that, because of this cutoffs, truncation, some information is lost. So sometimes I think in another place, I was asked whether one can go back. Can you go back from a fluid picture to particle picture? No, because you have already lost some information. You cannot go back. So plasmas exhibit a variety of waves. See, plasmas are actually known for waves, electrostatic, electromagnetic, mixed. And this is an important thing, quasi-longitudinal and quasi-transverse. See, ordinarily we know sound waves are longitudinal, radio waves are transverse. That we know ordinarily, right? But in a plasma, we can have intermediate mixed polarization. A particular wave mode can have it can be quasi-longitudinal or quasi-transverse, which means it's neither longitudinal nor transverse. It has features of both. So this is possible only in a plasma with magnetic field. Single fluid. Now I said two fluids or three fluids. Now we can go to a single fluid. That's even a simpler picture. So single fluid magnetohydrodynamics or MHD. So by appropriately combining the electron and the ion fluids, one gets the single fluid description. So these are the simplifications. See, we started with particles, then fluids, then from two fluids, we are now coming to single fluid. So these are the various simplifications, but nevertheless, very useful. We need not do kinetic treatment for every problem. It depends what question you are asking. Accordingly, you have to choose the methodology. See, for example, MHD phenomena, which I said by combining electron and ion fluids. For example, you want to explain the shape of this. You don't need kinetic treatment. So it is going along the magnetic field. So for any macroscopic configurational features, you can use MHD description. So for example, for these lobes here, and these are extragalactic jets. They are actually propagating huge distances without getting distorted. That's another problem. That stability of plasma of these jets and the tails, I already shown you. So this is MHD phenomenon. This can, if you want to explain the appearance, the configuration, the pressure, the velocity, just the macroscopic quantities of the plasma, then MHD picture is very good. It is sufficient, actually. So there are MHD waves in this fluid picture. Also, there are waves, Alphen waves, magnetosonic waves, and there are instabilities, configurational characteristics, pressure anisotropy. So if any one of these things exist in a plasma, the pressure is not isotropic, or if there is a density inhomogeneity, or if there is magnetic curvature, actually magnetic field always has a curvature, but depends on what length scale one is dealing with. So, and if there are flows in a plasma. So all these can make a plasma unstable. So stability of a plasma, macroscopic stability of a plasma is, it occupies the mind of many, many plasma physicists and astrophysicists. Because unless the plasma is stable, you cannot observe it. It would have a lifetime. It will decay in a few seconds or a few minutes. So if coronal mass ejections are traveling from sun to earth, they must retain their shapes or sizes or their other parameters during their propagation. Now, all these instabilities and waves, they give rise to turbulence. So most of the time in astrophysics, actually most regions are turbulent. And what is meant by turbulence is, it depends on the taste of the person, how you define. So basically, a very simple working definition one can give is that it has different types of waves of different frequencies and different wavelengths, and they are all interacting with each other. That's very important. So different scales, different time scales and spatial scales, but they are exchanging energy with each other. So those are the those regions which have such characteristics, they can be turbulent. So two fluid description now, electron fluid and ion fluid. So I said I gave you examples of single fluid, where all these coronal loops and jets and plasma tails can be modeled. So two fluids, what do we do with two fluids? Again, in two fluids, we have several types of waves. Just the frequencies I have indicated, waves and instabilities. For example, in solar corona, so electron plasma waves, ion acoustic waves, upper hybrid. And one important, I think, this Faraday rotation, probably everybody is familiar, especially the radio astronomers who measure it often, the plane of rotation of the plane of polarization of the radiation. So that is again because of the plasma frequency, omega EP is a measure of the plasma density and the magnetic field. So this is a measurable quantity. So you see, right, sometimes we feel, this is all in paper equations, and do we see it? We see it here in, for example, in Faraday rotation and also in depolarization. Certainly in the oscillations which we observe in, for example, you may observe some atomic line. The intensity may be oscillating at a certain frequency. So one of those frequencies could be in amongst these waves. They may be responsible for oscillation of the intensity of the spectral line. Partially ionized plasmas, electrons, ions, and neutrons. So three fluids. Now, one fluid, two fluids, three fluids. So the thing, life is becoming complicated. So we have, for the last few years, just before I retired, we started this work on partially ionized plasmas, and this mean field dynamo in partially ionized plasma, I think, was one of my earliest papers in this area, and published this with Professor Ramadhara. And so here, the main aim was that although traditionally we always learned that solar dynamo, occurs at the base of the convection zone. And but now with all these recent observations, so there's a lot of structure in the photospheric magnetic fields. And there is actually a very huge concern that if the field is produced at the base of the convection zone and then it propagates to the surface of the star or to the photosphere, does it remain intact? Is it really what was produced? Is it that what we are observing? On the way, it could change its magnitude, its shape, it can reconnect, disconnect, so many things can happen. So the question has been there for some time now, that whether the fields, magnetic fields that we observe on the solar surface, are they actually being produced at the base of the convection zone, or there is also contribution, local contribution from the solar photosphere. And solar photosphere, as I have already shown you, is partially ionized. So what does the mean field dynamo look like in a partially ionized plasma? So this is the first paper in this series which we want to investigate further, and this is one example of the three fluid picture of including electrons, ions, and neutrons. there was something Yeah, there was one more. There was one more bit. Okay, just one minute. So I have just was going to show one more example of this dynamo problem, local dynamo problem at the solar photosphere, which we have recently done last year. It has been published in Monthly Notices with Professor Chitre and some other colleagues. And so this field is quite new, and that's why I wanted to emphasize that a lot remains to be done in this field. And I think I'm going back and forth. So that's about it for the time being. I think I'm not taking too much of your time. It's just good time. So there's a lot remains to be done in this partially ionized field. And so in summary, you know, plasmas, partially ionized plasmas, and fully ionized plasmas are everywhere. And I hope, and you know, one thing that, especially for the youngsters, that don't get afraid of plasmas. It is just three laws of conservation: mass conservation, momentum conservation, energy conservation, and Maxwell's equation. That's all. There are no you know, mysterious equations or unnecessary complications, nothing. So just be comfortable with this very, very basic area of physics, and which of course you know, spans the whole universe, our laboratories, our labs, technology, agriculture, medicine, everywhere. So thank you very much for your attention. I had one summary slide, but it's not right. This is done. Let me see if something comes. So thank you so much for your attention.
Hello, Vinod.
Thank you for a very interesting talk.
Thank you.
You did a very comprehensive, you know, overview on plasma. And thank you again for a great presentation.
Thank you.
So the floor is now open for discussion.
Okay.
Yes. I think Arun Mangalam, you have a question. Please go ahead.
Hello, Vinod. Nice to see you.
I am not seeing you yet.
Okay, I haven't put on my video.
Why? Turn on your video.
Okay, I'll try and do that.
Why not? This is the only opportunity.
Well, okay.
Okay, tell me.
You're doing that, I just have a couple of... it's a very, as was already mentioned, friendly and a beautiful introduction to plasmas.
Okay.
In fact, I'm teaching a course and I would be... keen to have those slides.
It's, okay.
And as you mentioned, you know, there's always this trouble between equations and pictures.
Yes.
So, this thousand, you know, pictures worth thousand words.
Yes.
And so on. But my view is that one equation is worth a thousand pictures. So that's.
Okay, but, so, you know, I'm always very friendly, so I didn't want to put that number on that, but yes.
Yeah, I have a sort of a philosophical
yes, question. No, it's true, you know, see, each symbol is a picture, right? So if I know what it means.
Correct.
So for example, if you see a picture and you see a pink color, you may say, okay, this is H alpha. Mm-hmm. And same way, if I see a symbol rho, I say it is density, you know. So the diagnostics is quite clear.
Yeah. No, mm-hmm. I was taking off another point. Huh. The point being that you mentioned the collision frequencies between electrons and ion species, electrons and neutrons. The curious thing is that one is reduces with temperature, the other increases with temperature.
Yes, correct? Yes, yes.
So, you know, and recently there's been a lot of... discussion on reconnections. Reconnections has been receiving a lot of interest in the modern literature.
Mm.
So, and in this context, resistivity is a very important issue. Mm. And I was just wondering, since you've been working on the solar atmosphere, looking at partially ionized systems where all these frequencies do matter and its resistivity matters. You looked at the dynamo, the opposite case of generation, but resistivity and in flares and all these events, it's quite important. I was wondering whether there, as a function of temperature, you know, at various parts of the solar atmosphere, some of these processes could have some physically different characteristics because of the temperature variation.
Absolutely.
Comments on that.
See, for example, I mentioned.
I don't know if you can see my video. I turned on my video.
I have. I can see your forehead, and now I can see your eyes. Okay. Now I can see you.
Okay.
So, actually, that is very true. In fact, what I would suggest, we have actually done it some time back. I don't have the slide right now. You could take the photosphere up to chromosphere, from photosphere to chromosphere. You know the density, you know the temperature, whatever is listed by observers, and they have made these models, which are also called VAL model and Vernaza, and those names I've started forgetting, the VAL models. And if you just plot, you know, frequency, electron neutral collision frequency and electron ion collision frequency. So if you just plot them, you will see where one is dominant. Actually, this is dominant from photosphere to chromosphere. And there was one symposium in 2008. If you remember, Stan Flo was there, and you know, he was, for example, modeling the magnetic field on the solar surface as a turbulent. You know, they were at different scales, and they have found this k to the minus 5 by 3 kind of law for distribution of the magnetic field with different scales. Then, you know, the Kolmogorov scale, that is the dissipation scale, now that depends on the collision frequency, on the resistivity. Now, if you use electron ion or electron neutral, so that scale will be very different. And this is an observed, I mean, this could be observed. So what is the minimum scale of magnetic structure that you can observe? There you will have to use either one of these collision frequencies. But since electron neutral collision frequency is larger than EI, so you will get a different scale there.
Right.
So this is immediately a direct consequence of this. These people have ignored, even now, I don't think anybody has taken into account that.
Yeah, because I think this has applications to reconnections also, I believe. People haven't looked at it.
Because in reconnection, you do need resistivity, otherwise you won't reconnect.
And there are things like anomalous resistivity and things like that.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
Thank you.
Hi Vinod, this is Sujan here.
Oh, hey Sujan, how are you?
I am very nice to see you after a long time.
Yeah, I know. It's so difficult to travel, and now all this corona is there, so we cannot.
For the last few months, I am hearing about plasma treatment of corona. Now, somewhat free that you have given some other form of plasma.
Yeah. But no, it is not only, in fact, since you mentioned. I am just right now examining a thesis in which they are calculating social distancing. They're estimating social distance, what is necessary to avoid this virus spreading, because virus is maybe carried by aerosols.
Yeah, this is a hydrodynamic problem. This is also the mask. Yeah, the mask, how the mask will protect it, how much. Yeah.
So one can actually, because these aerosols carrying virus, they are spreading through a turbulent atmosphere.
Yes, yes. So their velocity, their density, number density, all are depends on that.
Yes, yes. So this is this is a very direct application of this. And another point, you know, these atmospheric aerosols, even without the virus, they were being detected by plasma instrumentation. You know, because what a plasma does, plasma is released in the atmosphere. What it does is it endows the aerosols salts with the electric charge. And then they can be captured. See, anything, if you make it electrically charged, it's easier to capture than a neutral body. So that's what a plasma does. Yeah.
I have a very naive question, actually. Yeah. Since you are telling that an equation is worth of 1,000 images, but yeah, that is true for expert and specialist, not for me.
Well, who have been dealing with equations?
What I'm telling that when you describe the plasma thing by energy conservation, by mass conservation, by momentum conservation, do you need a equation of state to complete it? Is there any different equation of state or matter of the same equation of state of matter can describe it?
No. See, when we say energy conservation, that is actually, that contains the equation of state.
Okay.
Yeah. So, for example, for adiabatic processes, we can have adiabatic equation of state.
So, you do not need to relate the pressure or anything.
Pressure doesn't come. And temperature. Yes, you have to relate the two, because in MHD, in fluid treatment, it is not given automatically. What you need is pressure. What you know is pressure. What you know is density. You don't know the relationship between them. That is what the equation of state gives.
Yes.
That you have to furnish additionally.
Yes, but here in any of your equation, I didn't see any pressure term, the capital P. That's why I was wondering that whether you can escape it for the plasma.
No, because that is actually included in the energy equation.
I see. Okay.
In a very simplified form, the energy equation, translates to adiabatic or isothermal equation of state. It is the same thing. We don't use energy conservation as well as equation of state. We use one of the two.
And this phase transition also dependent on pressure also then? See, natural matter, liquid, gas and solid, there is a phase transition which depends on pressure or temperature.
Yes. But, this is a good point. This plasma is actually not a phase transition. Going from gas to plasma is not a phase transition.
Okay.
So that is why I qualified. Why is it called the fourth state?
Oh, so it is
because
just
the three are phase transitions. Solid to liquid is a phase transition. Liquid to gas is a phase transition. Exactly. Gas to plasma is not a phase transition, but since plasma has such different and very unique properties, it is qualified as a state, but it's not a phase transition.
Thank you.
Are there any more questions or comments from the participants?
Gangadhara,
if you want to say something, you have to unmute.
Yeah, say hello at least. Hello, Ganga.
Hi. How are you, madam?
I'm fine. How are you? Long time.
Nice to listen to your talk. It's very basic, fundamental. You made it very clear. Plasma.
So, it's all clear to you. You don't need to.
I was almost like a student. I was listening to your talk. So, all of things, what you are talking about, plasma, it was very interesting to listen to you.
Thank you.
I have one question.
Yes.
You didn't touch upon that. That is one is electron positron plasma.
Oh, yes, sir. See, that I just included in quantum plasmas as a part of quantum plasmas.
I deal with such plasma in the pulsar magnetosphere.
Yes. Yes. So we have a joint paper. We have a joint paper on electron positron plasma.
Yes. So what is your opinion on this electron positron plasma in pulsar magnetic field?
Because
magnetic field is very high.
Yes.
We consider plasma is the motion is almost one dimensional.
Yes.
It follows the field lines.
Yes.
And then even Melrose, many people have written plasma instability sets in.
Yes.
And then excitation of these waves, but the plasma, the electron positron plasma, are likely to annihilate also.
Mm.
and then these instabilities are set in, but all these are one-dimensional motion.
Yes. So, see, you have to see the difference, you know, difference between electron, proton and electron, positron, plasma, you know the difference.
Yes.
So in the plasma frequencies will be different in the two cases.
Yes.
In the first case, it is only electron plasma frequency. But yes. As electron, positron, plasma, you have to include positrons also.
Yes.
So the inertia will change.
Yes.
Both the species will contribute to your plasma frequency. Yes. So that is the main thing. And second thing is, maybe you cannot use classical distribution function.
Yes.
You use a Fermi-Dirac distribution.
Distribution.
So that's why it becomes then a quantum plasma.
Yes.
Of course, not many people, they don't always use quantum plasmas. But if the densities are high enough, you will have to use quantum plasmas.
Yes. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Nice seeing you.
Yes.
So, Aruna?
Yes?
Kameshwar Rao has a comment in YouTube.
Oh, yeah. So, we have some people joining us through YouTube. So, Kameshwar Rao says, hi, Vinod. Nice talk.
Thank you, Kameshwar. Where is he? Can I see him?
No, actually,
no, he's in the
through YouTube channel.
Okay.
And we also have a message from Uday Shankar, and he says, very nice talk.
Oh, Uday is there.
Yeah.
Thank you, Uday. Thank you.
And then there is one more person called Sumukha. She also says, thank you, ma'am, for your talk, maybe. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for listening.
Madam, they can see you and they can hear you.
Okay.
Okay, so if there are no more discussions or questions, then let us thank again Professor Vinod Kishan. Very, very, really, very interesting talk. And yes, nice to see you after a long time.
Yes.
You're doing so well.
You're doing a wonderful job.
So thank you, and I'll formally close the session now.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Vinod. Bye-bye. Take care.
Bye.
Bye, Vinod. Take care.
Bye.